So we'll start our class. So we are on a way towards discussion of the microcomputers and structures. And then we were deriving that there will be a microprocessor with control unit and arithmetic logic unit inside it. So we, in an earlier discussion, we made large scale integration, medium scale integration, very large scale integration, small scale integration. So if in this model, when we talk about the microcomputer, so microcomputer, we are going to call it as a large scale integration. And the most important thing was, it was on a single chip. So what will be the basic things to do, or to determine the basic functions of a microprocessor? So the very first thing was, it has to fetch the data, then it has to process the data, and then it has to give the output. When it is going to process the things, the most important thing was, it is going to do in form of instructions, in form of control signals. So this is what the takeaway from this slide. So in a microcomputer, the central processing unit is the CPU, which it is going to fetch the data, process the data, that is, instructions are going to be executed, and then there will be the control signals, etc., followed by the generation of the output. So a short form for a microprocessor, we call it as MU, and MU stands for micro. So micro instructions are going to be processed. That too, they are going to be materialized via the transistors, and they are going to be built on a semiconductor integrated chip. So this is all regarding some of the definitions of a microcomputer. And another definition was, we do have a microcomputer, which it is going to be called as a digital computer also. And there are some other terms which we can redefine the word to a personal computer, like a PC, like that. Now, the microcomputers, they are going to have some extended versions, and those extension versions, we are going to call them as servers, or we are going to call it as mainframe computers, or we call it as a supercomputers. So we have a rack server in our college, where the entire lab circuitry of all the labs, they are with the local area network, and then they are connected to the computer labs, to the other systems and all. So that is where a server is going to have a holistic control over the different clients. Second thing was a IBM mainframe computer. So you have heard about a software called as SAP. So people who are going to learn SAP, they will directly work on the mainframe computers. Third thing was, we have Cray, an IBM Cray. So this was a supercomputer. So Google, Microsoft, whatever, Facebook, WhatsApp, whatever it is. So these, they will do 1 billion or 1 trillion instructions per second. At that time, a normal desktop computer, a laptop computer, will not be able to meet that speed. So we need to have this supercomputers for the Gmail or Yahoo or WhatsApp, Facebook, Instagram, whatever it is. So those, they are going to be maintained by the supercomputer. And the Indian made supercomputer was PARAM, Param. And this, it was one instance, it is in CDAC, Bangalore. So the government organization CDAC, Bangalore, they are going to maintain this Param supercomputer, and it will be as a house size. So you should, we had an opportunity to visit it, and it will be as big as a 2 or 3 cent house. So how much is that capacity? That much capacity, the server, the supercomputer racks, supercomputer setup will be established. So why it is so vast, why it is so volume in sense? Because it should execute 1 million or 1 trillion transactions every second. So if we are using WhatsApp and if click just OK, hi, whatever it is, so everything will have to pass to the server, then communicate to the client, that too in less than seconds of time. So that much processing speed has to be there. Therefore, the supercomputers, they work with more speed. Yeah. The another way of putting the things was, along with the central processing unit, we do have the random access memory, and we do have the read-only memory. And the input-output devices, they are going to be controlled with the I/O ports. So we have already an enough discussion on these items. Now let us look some of the characteristics of the microprocessor. The very first characteristic was that we need to call it as instruction set. Around 110 instructions, around 110 instructions are there for a 8086 microprocessor. So this is nothing but we call it as some reserved words. So how you have reserved words in Python, how you have reserved words for C, Java, or DBMS, and SQL. In the same way, microprocessors do have some reserved words. So for example, I can call it as MOV. I can call it as add with carry. So I can call it as sign multiplication. So in this way, there are a lot of commands, opcodes, which they are going to be there to give programming to the microprocessor directly. So such is where we are going to call that item as set of instructions. Next thing was, the second factor what we are going to measure as a scalability feature will be the bandwidth. So how many bits the processor it is going to process at a time in an instruction, so that it is going to be taken up in a bandwidth. So it can be 8, 16, 32, 64. So the configuration will vary from laptop to laptop, will vary from operating system to operating system. So now if you are working on a Core i3 laptop, and if you are working on Windows 10 operating system, 8 or 10 and above, then you are going to work with the 64-bit operating system. So the chipset, it is going to have 64 bits working in parallel. So at a time, 64 bits will work in parallel. So that is where the advantage of the bandwidth is going to take up. The third feature what the microprocessor will be looking up will be the capability. So how much is cycles? So number of cycles to execute an instruction. Number of cycles needed to execute an instruction. So that is what we call it as a capability feature. So in one unit interval of time, that is in 1 minute, so how many instructions a microprocessor can do? So every instruction is having 4 cycles. First phase will be an initialization. Next phase will be decoding. then it will be executing and then the rendering of the output. So every instruction has to go up with the four phases. So that is how many instructions are going to be processed in some unit interval of time. So that is one of a characteristic what the microprocessor will need. Okay, fine. Now we were talking about some cycles, etc. Now that cycles need to be executed, then a speed is going to come into a picture. So that is nothing but the heads. Heads stands for heads. So how much speed the microprocessor is going to execute our instruction? It is megahertz, gigahertz, etc. So in the central processing unit, we will have a crystal oscillator. We will have a crystal oscillator. So this crystal oscillator, it is going to generate the clock pulses. It is going to generate the clock pulses. So either low or either high. So 0 to 1, 1 to 0. So those items we are going to call it as clock pulses. So in the central processing unit, we are going to have a crystal oscillator, and this crystal oscillator, it is going to generate the clock pulses. So these clock pulses, they are going to be measured in hertz. Now coming to the definition of a clock speed. So clock speed, it is going to determine how many operations per second it is going to perform, and that is what we are going to call it as clock rate here. So definitely every computer is incorporated with a crystal oscillator. Even a mobile phone is done with a crystal oscillator, where it is going to impulse lot of clock pulses. That too it is doing with a digital data, and it is going to be measured with megahertz or gigahertz or terahertz, petahertz, etc. Now one of the most important characteristic of a microprocessor was word length. So this is the basic definition of a microprocessor unit, what we need to bring it up. So it is going to depend upon the width of the internal bus. So that means it can be with 8-bit data bus, it can be either 16-bit data bus, either it can be 64-bit data bus. So number of data lines, it is going to decide the word length. So how many bits it can process at a time. So this was the first and foremost way of putting the word length in practice. So how many number of bits it can do it in parallel at a time, we are going to measure that as a word length. And where it is dependent on? It is dependent on the registers. It can be 8-bit register, it can be 16-bit registers, etc. Followed by the way in which the arithmetic and logic unit is going to process up the instructions. So when it was some 8085, it will do 8-bit instructions. When it was some 8086, it was 16-bit instruction. So what is 8085? What is 8086? So you are aware that Redmi Note 8, Redmi Note 10, Redmi Note 12. So you are aware of these terms. Similarly, microprocessor has those evaluation, that is 4004 to Core i3, i5, i7 and i9. So you are aware of Apple generation mobile phones. So i4, i10, so i12. So in this way, you measure up the iPhone sizes and iPhone new models. Similarly, microprocessor has new models, and every model has its own features. So in general, it can vary from 4-bit to 64-bit. So that is what we are going to look into. Now, the word length will specify up the data bits, will specify with the address bits. As far as 8086 microprocessor is going to concern, it is going to have 16-bit data bus and it is going to have 20-bit address bus. So our syllabus, we are confining it to 8086 microprocessor. So as far as 8086 microprocessor is going to be concerned, the data bus, it is of 16 bits, and the address bus, it is going to have a width of 20 bits. So what was the distinguishing bus? At a time, it can hold 16 bits. At a time, it can hold 20 bits. For example, I just want to write 7, 8, 6, 9. Now I can write 0111 100 0110 1001. So now I can say this is 16 bits at a time. The digital data is going to be held by the CPU. So how many number of bits we can process at a time is going to be a word length, and that word length will illustrate it towards the data bus, will illustrate with the width of the address bus. So generally addressing will be mapped to 2 power n. Addressing will be mapped to 2 power n. If I am going to say 1024, then we are going to call it as kilobytes, that is 2 power 10. If I am going to say 1 MB, then I am going to call it as 1024, right? So into 2 power 10. So in this way, we are going to bring up every illustration of a memory in form of 2 power n. So this is the where the capability of an address is going to be taken up. Next thing was, microprocessor do have data types. Microprocessor do have data types. So in C and Java, we have short int, int, long int, float, double, boolean. In the same way, microprocessor has the same type of data types like character, number, string. So these are where it is with binary number system, with the binary coded decimal number system, with the American standard code for information interchange, ASCII codes, or with the signed, or we are going to call it as unsigned. So the major word of distinction is, give me 10 rupees. So I am not telling plus 10 rupees, right? I am not mentioning the sign of 10 rupees. By default, you and I will assume it is a positive number. So such is what we are going to call it as unsigned numbers. But when we are going to bring up with an item with a signed number, we identify the position, whether it is going to be a signed number or an unsigned number. Excuse me. Now, if I'm going to write some 8-bit position, so one, it is going to indicate a negative number. But if I'm going to put this zero at the most significant bits, then we are going to indicate it as a positive number. So this was the difference. So if I'm going to put zero here, then we are going to call it as a positive number. And if I'm going to put one at the most significant bit, or at the high order bits, then we are going to call here as a negative number. So the data types, what we were mentioning was a binary coded decimal numbers, American standard code for information interchange, and signed number. Definitely it will be a positive number or a negative number. Unsigned number, by default, it is going to be a positive number. So If I'm dealing about currency, 100 rupees, 200 rupees, obviously they are positive numbers. You feel it is a positive number, I feel it is a positive number. Meaning is conveyed. Minus 5, that means I am telling you before 5 there is minus. That means I am communicating you the sign. So such is sign number. Then how I am doing representation for sign? I am going to use this sign with a 8-bit number. So that is how we are going to categorize the data type of a country. Next thing was the interrupt capability. So every instruction in CPU is processed via interrupt. Is processed by an interrupt. That means we are unpredictable items, random events. So when I am lecturing my class, some students may turn on their audio or video. So obviously some disturbance is going to happen. It is not intentional. It is not intentional. Everybody knows it is not intentional. So by mistake it is coming up, then automatically you will mute yourself. So the ignorance or the unpredictable item happened at that time, we say an unforeseen event, we are going to call that one as an interrupt. So everything CPU will do some instructions, when some new action has to be taken that will come and disturb the CPU job, we are going to call that item as an interrupt. So you are watching your YouTube or you are listening some music, all of a sudden somebody will ask you, go, where is the book? So you get disturbed in listening the music and you have to give the book to the other person. So that disturbance, what it is going to happen to you, that when we put it into the computer science terminology, it is going to be called here as an interrupt. So every instruction for a CPU, it is going to be processed via the interrupts. So in an unit interval of time, the number of interrupts a CPU is driven at that time, we measure it, and that it is going to improve the performance of the CPU. So every event is going to be processed via the interrupts, and CPU performance or throughput is going to be taken up via this interrupt form. Yeah. Next thing, another feature of a microprocessor will be the cost. So in general, when compared to supercomputer, when compared to a mainframe computer, when compared to a server, the laptops are cheap, right? So Google, they work with supercomputers. So we don't even dare to ask our parents to buy me a supercomputer. So it is a cost effect. So a laptop between 50,000 to 1 lakh. So that is the optimal size for us. And when we compare our laptop to a supercomputer or a mainframe computer, obviously the cost was low. So in general, the lowest version of a microprocessor or a microcomputer was low. So in general usage. Next thing, the size is going to impact a lot. So you can see your laptop screen sizes. If it is older version laptops, they will be 16 inches, 17 inches. So now you people, you are buying 15 inches laptop or 14 inches laptop. So you can measure it with your scale. So how much is the size of your screen of your laptop? So when size is going to make a crucial factor at this point of time, how is this done? Means the fabrication technology of a chip, they are going to embed the components so small, so compact, that it is with a compactness feature, because size is going to play a major role, because we people, we like the portability. So we should be in a position to carry the laptop from one place into another position. If not, we would have used desktops, right? So if not, we would have used desktops. So as there is a portability feature to a laptop, so that is the reason why we're purchasing laptops and working on it. If laptop and desktop, there is no difference, we should have worked on a desktop. So similarly, What is the size is maintaining here? It was that the chip fabrication technology, what we are going to consider, the compaction of that transistors or diodes, whatever it is in the chip, they are very less in size, but the same functionality will remain. Yeah, next thing was the features like power consumption. So in general, CMOS technology, composite metal oxide semiconductor technology, is a thing what a microprocessor is going to be constructed. So why this CMOS technology is going to be maintained means the main intention was it should consume very, very low power. And next thing was we should be very versatile to different type of applications. So that means in one end I can use web WhatsApp, another end I can use email, another I can use YouTube. So in this way, parallel programming, parallel applications can be configured on my desktop screen. I can switch from one computer to another computer, and I can alter from one situation to another situation. So number of applications can be programmed in parallel by the microprocessor. So that is where a feature such as a versatility is going to be taken. The other thing was a reliability. So definitely whatever intention the microprocessor is going to be matured, so the same task can happen at any moment of time. If the processor is gone, it is in a position that we can replace that processor and get our work done. So the failure rate of a microprocessor will be very, very less. So we never had, even when maybe you are using two or three mobile phones changing rapidly, but there won't be any complaint that my CPU is not working, right? You never changed a processor, you never changed a mobile phone, my CPU is not working. So nobody gets that complaint. Only the complaint is different characteristics of the things are going to be affected, but there you will not listen, the CPU in the mobile phone is not working. So that complaint you will not hold. The reason was the processor was so reliable, so there won't be almost nullifying troubleshooting will happen in the microprocessor and it works perfectly. Yeah. Next thing was how is this microprocessor taken up means we are using a simple called as a MIU. We are going to use this MIU and it is going to be a unit length for 1 million to a meter, etc. So 10 power 6. So this is all regarding the different characteristics of the microprocessor, what we were talking of. After this microprocessor is going to be done, next one, we will look into a new topic that was the different evaluations of the microprocessor. So this was the topic what we can now take up. So coming to the new topic, and the new topic was microprocessor evaluation and types in the Intel 8086 family. So we were talking about word length. So when we are going to call it as a word length, it says number of bits a microprocessor will work in parallel. Number of bits a microprocessor will work in parallel. So this was the main intention of this. Now there are microprocessors which are going to work with 8-bit, 4-bit, 16-bit, 32-bit and 64-bit. So you are very fortunate kids and you are born when using this 64-bit mobile phone and 64-bit laptop. So you will never ever have worked on 4-bit, 8-bit, 16-bit. Maybe 5 years back you have worked on 32-bit, but you are very fortunate to work on the 64-bit processors. Either in the mobile phone you are working on 64 bits only, either in laptops also you are working on 64 bits. So you never tolerate disturbance. So when a pic or an image, when it is downloading from internet speed, you don't have the tolerance. So patience, etc. If you are working on this 4-bit, 8-bit means, I think you'll be completely upset. So this is what we are going to say. So for example, Core i3, Core i5, Core i7, Core i9. So this is the processors what we are, the laptops what you are now working on. So maybe these are the only things you are purchased. Similarly, when you are working on mobile phones right now in your hands, you will be having octa-core or quad-core mobiles. So this is very high-end configuration. So you are fortunate to work on this 64-bit processor. So if I want to understand 64-bit processor, first I should understand what is a processor, how 4 bits are done, how to work with 8 bits, then I can apply it with a 64-bit. So even in machine learning also, there will be a lot of samples. In 2 or 3 samples, we will work and we will push to the population, and then we will say, as this feature is there, other we also are going to have the same. So similarly, we will work on 16-bit processors, that is 8086, and then we will have an experience how exactly a microprocessor is going to work. The only ease in the world to understand programming on a microprocessor was 8085 or 8086. So if I want to work directly with memory locations, understand directly how C pointers are implemented, etc., then 8085 and 8086 are the two better options. 8085 is a 8-bit and 8086 is 16-bit. So coming to the very first way of putting the things, we do have this semiconductor technology, and yeah, there the first integrated chip, IC stands for the integrated chip, and this integrated chip was formed in 1957, and you can see the persons who has designed the semiconductors was Robert Noyce and Gordon Moore, so Andrew Wu, etc. And then this is what we are going to call Intel Electronics. Sorry, Intel Integrated Electronics. So this is the name of an Intel. I don't know much more people you can know this definition also. So Intel stands for Integrated Electronics, and they have formed this, and we will discuss on Moore's law also. We will also have an enough discussion in the coming slides regarding the Moore's law. And yeah, so coming to the very first version of the IC, it was 8404, and this is the chip what you are visualizing at this point of time, a 4004 chip. It was invented in 1971. Even your parents may not have one. And then the first microprocessor by Intel, and it is going to be a 4-bit microprocessor, and it is going to work with a speed of some 740 kilohertz, and it is made up of some 2300 transistors, and it is going to unit interval of a second, it executes 60,000 instructions. So 60,000 instructions in 1971, a microprocessor was able to do it. The next version was 4040, and it was in 1974. And again, it is a 4-bit microprocessor. And the second, the generation was with an Intel 8008, which was with 1972. And from 4-bit, it has been moved up to the 8-bit structure, and it is going to work with some clock speed of 500 kilohertz. And yeah, it could also do 50,000 instructions per second. And the other Intel processor was some 8080. So in 8080, yeah, it was invented in 1974. So it is of 8-bit microprocessor, and the clock speed when compared to the previous version, it is 2 megahertz, and number of transistors was 6,000, and it works 10 times faster than the previous. So this is all regarding the 8080. So on the chip, you can visit the configuration of the chips. So these are very rare picks. So you can't see a 5 paise coin, 10 paise coin, 15, 25 paise coin. So, but when you look at 5 paise, 10 paise, 25 paise coins, how exaggeration you feel. Similarly, for the hardware people, when they look on these chips, so such type of excitement will be created. So this was the chip which was for 8085. So over 100 million copies were sold. This is the hit model, you can say, and it is 1976 made, and yeah, it is going to be of 8-bit microprocessor, and the clock speed was 3 megahertz. And now from here the pace changes. So we have address bus, we have data bus. So address bus is going to be 16-bit, and data bus is going to be 8-bit, and around 769,230 seconds instructions can be processed. In 1976, scientists, they made a microprocessor, they made a chip inside a laptop, inside a desktop, inside a mobile phone. So that chip, it can, how many instructions it can process was around 7 lakh instructions. And what was the accessible memory to that chip was, it is 2^7. So 64 kilobytes of memory is going to be taken up. Now coming to the syllabus, our next 2-3 months working model, that is what we call here as our Intel 8086. So in this Intel 8086, it is going to be a 40 pin. So in the next discussion, we'll have the block diagram, the architecture of 8086. So we'll discuss what this pin will do, why, what is the use of this pin. So all 40 pins, they have their own work. So our 5 fingers are there. Every finger has its own specialty. Every finger to be united to bring a universal purpose. Similarly, the every pin in the microprocessor will have its own work, will have its own job, and they all constitute to work for the microprocessor. Now coming to this, the very first chip, we are going to say here it is 16-bit microprocessor, and how many clock speeds it can generate. So there are some different versions. It is 4.77, 8 megahertz, 10 megahertz. So there are three versions. So different versions are going to be there. And next one, the data bus. So the data bus was 16-bit, and address bus was 20-bit. So this is what you have to memorize. So how many data bits at a time a microprocessor, it is going to work? It will be 16-bit. How many address bits a Intel 8086 microprocessor is going to work means it is of 20-bit address. So this is the key takeaway. And how many number of transistors are going to be used to burn this 8086 will be some 29,000. And how many instructions it is going to execute means it is going to do up with the 2.5 million instructions per second it is going to execute. And the accessibility 2 power 20. So 2 power 20, it is going to give up 1 megabyte of memory. So 1 megabyte of memory will be the random access memory, the primary memory for the 8086. So at a time, it can work with 1 megabyte of memory, not all. So the number of instructions, yeah, it is going to be taken up with some 22,000 instructions. So this is what the first and foremost takeaway of Intel 8086. Data bus is of 16, address bus is of 20, clock speed of 4.76, 778 or 10. Data bus size is 16, address bus size is 20. Number of transistors it is going to constitute will be 29,000. And the maximum memory it can work will be the 1 megabyte of memory. The extension versions to this 16-bit came up in 1978. So it was introduced in 1978. So this is regarding the 8086. And again, the next version of 8086 was Intel 8088. And it is of some 16-bit microprocessor again. And it is little bit cheaper when compared to 86. And yeah, of course, it is going to have a 16-bit processor and there is some external bus. So data bus, address bus, control bus. So they are again extended with some 8-bit. And the number of instructions it can execute per a second was 2.5. And yeah, the same speed it is going to work up. And people who are working in IBM, they have adopted this chip, 8086 chip, and they developed the laptops and desktops. So you people, the chip you are using in your laptop will be Core i3 or i5 or i7. In your mobiles, they will be Core, quad core or octa core processors by Snapdragon, etc. from mobile or Intel or AMD for your desktops. Now, coming to the other thing, we have the advanced versions of Intel processors. So these, the chip size, you can see they are far bit improved. And the number of pins are going to be more, and still they are going to work on 16-bit data, and the clock speed they are going to work with 8 megahertz. And they are going to have some more components which was involved. One, it is going to have some interrupt controller. So every instruction will process via an interrupt that is taken up with an interrupt controller. Next thing, the clock generator. So number of clock pulses it is going to work up. Third thing, the local bus controller to deal with address bus, data bus, and control bus. And it is going to have an up-down counter, top-down counter, ripple counter, bidirectional shift register, shift-up, shift-down registers. So shift register with parallel load. So all these, they are going to be part with this local bus controllers and towards the counting elements in 80186 and 188. The next version of the evaluation of the microprocessor is of 80286. It was again taken up by the Integrated Electronics Intel, and it is of 1982 version. Again, the word length what we are going to see here, it is of 16-bit, and the clock speed, yeah, it is still 8 megahertz. And now the data bus is not improved, but the address bus is improved. That is 2 power 24. Now it is going to have an access to a memory of 16 megabytes of memory. So that was the thing. And number of instructions it can do up will be 4 million instructions. So when there is a question for you to give evaluation of computers, so you need to start from 404 8008 8080 8085 86 186 286. And the third thing we are going to have with the 80386 microprocessors. And this 80386 microprocessor, it came in the market in 1986. And it is going to work with some 32-bit microprocessor. And what is the difference? Earlier was our data bus size was 16 to the previous. Now it is going to be improved here to 32-bit, and address bus, earlier it is some 2 power 20, 2 power 24. Now it is going to be improved to 32-bit, that is 2 power 32. Now it is going to access around 4 gigabytes of memory. Around 4 gigabytes of memory is going to be handled. So there, the advantage of 80386 came into picture. And number of transistors, now it were earlier it was with thousands happening. Now you can see it is improved to 275,000 transistors. And earlier the clock speed was 4, 8, and 10. Now the clock speed, it has been improved from 16 to 33. There are different versions in 80386. We call it as DX version, SX version, and SL version. So when you purchase mobile phones, when you purchase cars, etc., you say Alta DX, Alta DL, so on. So these are different versions in cars like that. Similarly, Redmi Note A, Note B or something, and Pro. So different versions for the mobile phone. So similarly, for Intel version also, we have different versions like DX, SX, SL. So different versions, they do have their different names to their different versions. And after 8086 microprocessor, 80386 was the leading market vendor which was dominated. The other things after 80386. So we will continue our class. Yeah, we'll stop here. And